All right, everybody, well, welcome to this year's Memorial Day ceremony. I'm Russ Harden, and I'll be the MC for today. So, Memorial Day is a federal holiday for remembering the people who died while serving our country. Originally known as Decoration Day, it originated in the years following the Civil War as a time of the nation to decorate the graves of Civil War veterans. After World War I, it was extended to include all military personnel who died in military service. And in 1968, Congress passed the Uniform Monday Holiday Act, which established Memorial Day as the last Monday in May, and it became effective in law in 1971 as official federal holiday. This time, I ask everybody to please rise for the posting of the colors and remain standing for the national anthem and the Pledge of Allegiance. Singing of the national anthem will be by Councilmember Paul McGowan. He'll be singing the national anthem, and Councilman McGowan's grandpa, John LaMorada, was an outstanding member of the Heritage Band of Troy for many years, and he played the alto sax. This time, I'd like to call up Mayor Pro Tem Ellen Horderick. She'll come up and lead us in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, everybody, please be seated. This time I'd like to call up Chaplain Bob Cornwall. He's from the Central Woodward Christian Church to give us the invocation.
Will you join me in prayer? God of peace, we come here today to remember women and men who gave their lives in service to this country. We remember them and their sacrifice with grateful hearts. We also come to this place to remember all of our loved ones who have died and no longer walk with us. They have may not died in service to country, but they have come to our minds and hearts this day. We give thanks for their lives and their influence on our own lives. We not only gather to remember those who have died, but also wish to remember families left behind. We remember and offer our prayers for family members who grieve their loss of loved ones, parents, spouses, children, siblings. We come to lay wreaths in their honor. We salute the bravery of those who serve this country, always hoping that when they are deployed, they will return home safely, but always knowing that a different fate might await them and us. Even as we remember those who died in service to country, we also come here today hoping that one day such sacrifices will not be necessary. We look forward to the day when, as the prophet declared, swords will be beaten into plowshares and spears into pruning hooks. As we gather here today as a community sharing different faiths, different ideologies, different ethnicities, may the example of those who gave their lives defending ideals of liberty and justice for all inspire those of us left behind to pursue these ideals and build bridges of understanding and hope in this community and beyond. Amen.
Okay, at this time I'm going to introduce some of the dignitaries that are in attendance with us today. As I call your name, please stand up. And if you'd hold your applause till the end, we'll get through it and recognize everybody. So, today we have with us Mayor Pro Tem Ellen Hodrick, Council Member Paul McGowan, former Mayor Gene Stein, and I think we have former Councilman Robin Beltramini. Okay, thank you guys. Thanks for attending. All right, so now my pleasure to introduce today's keynote speaker, which is Petty Officer Second Class Rocco Ottolino. Petty Officer Second Class Rocco Ottolino enlisted in the United States Navy in 1989 via the Naval Nuclear Power Program. He attended basic training, nuclear field day school, and Naval Nuclear Power School in Orlando, Florida. Following the successful completion of his military education, Rocco was stationed in Connecticut to the Nuclear Prototype Training Unit for qualification on a S-1C submarine reactor. It was the tight quarters experience that led him to request a reassignment to an aircraft carrier. That's one extreme to the other. Rocco reported to sea duty for the USS Abraham Lincoln in Alameda, California in May of 1991, just 2 weeks prior to the first Western Pacific cruise. Shortly after in June was the eruption of Mount Pinatubo in the Philippines, and the USS Lincoln was called into action for another first rescue and support mission. He received a Humanitarian Service Medal for the Operation Fury Vigil. Through his remaining years, he received the following awards and decoration: the National Defense Service Medal, Sea Service Deployment Ribbon with Bronze Star, Armed Forces Expeditionary Medal, Southwest Asia Service Medal with Bronze Star, Battle E Ribbon, and Naval Good Conduct Medal. After 6 years in the military service, Rocco went on to receive a Bachelor's of Science in Electrical Engineering from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. He commenced his second career in telecommunications at Motorola. He received an engineering award for development of a proprietary software algorithm, and immediately after September 11, 2001, he was part of an engineering team that provided an antenna system to triangulate victims of the terror attack in New York City by tracking cell signals. The aftermath of Hurricane Katrina 2005 led him to become a co-inventor and a patent to minimize critical communication downtime. Rocco moved to Hawaii for a year-long sabbatical of hiking and touring the islands with future spouses. After all that, I would think that would be a retirement, not a sabbatical. In 2011, he moved back to Michigan and soon after enrolled in the biomedical engineering program at Wayne State University, where he received a Master's of Science degree. This experience has led him to Beaumont. Rocco is charging forward on a new trajectory that has been seen him and recognized in Cranes Detroit for designing an oxygen tank holder to assist nursing staff. He is currently a senior healthcare equipment planner for the health system, but you can still find him collaborating on the development of new medical devices and enjoying being a father of his two sons. That was an impressive bio there, sir. So at this time, I'll welcome Rocco.
Good morning. Thanks, everyone. Happy Memorial Day. So my name is Rocco Adelino. I'm a first-generation American whose parents immigrated to the United States from Italy in 1967. I served in the Navy for 6 years during the first Gulf War. I entered in July of 1989, and I saw my exit in 1995. So it'll have been 22 years this July that I've been out of the service. But I remember my time served as if it was yesterday. My reasons for joining the military were not much different than many of the young men and women who find themselves joining today. I wanted to see the world, gain experience, get some money for college. But whatever the reasons for serving our country, today is a day we remember and honor all the brave soldiers and sailors who didn't make it back home. I told some friends that I was saying a few words for Memorial Day here at Troy. And of course, I received no less than a dozen pictures of me in an ill-fitting uniform singing in the Navy by the village people. Some young faces here, they might need a little explanation. I could see my nieces and nephews in the back asking what a village person is. I used to love my friends. So we're here to celebrate what we call Memorial Day. And as I started to look more into it, I found there's a longer history than I had realized. We say Memorial Day now, but it used to also be known as Remembrance Day. It has its roots dating back to ancient Greece and Rome. And similarly, families would lay flowers at grave sites to pay their respects. In slightly more modern times, and this might be a little bit of a repeat, but after the Civil War, we started formally recognizing Remembrance Day. And it wasn't until the early 1970s that Memorial Day became a national holiday. It took me a long time to understand my contribution, but 9/11 changed that for me, and I imagine many others. To me, Memorial Day is a serious and solemn occasion, one that makes me feel introspective, brings out those painful memories that, you know, we tend to keep buried deep down inside because we have a job to do or a family to care for. We're just too busy. But it's also a day that makes us be able to walk with our heads high because we know our fellow shipmates and soldiers didn't fall in vain. We owe them more than a day of gratitude. We owe them really for the way that we live our lives. I'm proud to have served my country. I was not part of the greatest generation that fought in World War II, like my wife's grandparents were. I didn't have to face the poor treatment that Vietnam veterans did when they returned home, like my father-in-law did. And I'm not stuck with the nightmares of all those who are fighting today. I've been very fortunate. And I'm also fortunate to work for a health system that has leaders who value the strengths and the characters that veterans bring. I'd like to thank Beaumont. I'd like to thank the city of Troy, everyone here, for allowing me to say a few words. And as we move past today and next week or next month, there are things in life that are going to take the wind out of our sails, but we can and must persevere. So there's the saying, when there's no clear path around our obstacles, we have to push past them. And in doing so, we honor those that have made the ultimate sacrifice. We provide brief moments of silence out of respect. But I say, share your memories, share your stories, whatever manner makes you feel most comfortable doing it. And that way, it'll help us all remember how important today really is. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rocco. I understand that State Representative Martin Horlack is here. Marty? He's over there. He is, yeah. Give him a round of applause. Thank him for attending today. Good job, Rocco. Thank you very much. Okay, at this time, the Heritage Band is going to play each service song, so when you're service song is played, if you'd stand up, that'd be excellent. So, all right. Navy! Force.
Coast Guard.
Thank you very much. Okay, this time we're going to conduct the laying of the wreath ceremony. Rocco, if you would please come up and assist with that. This will be conducted by the Troy Police Honor Guard, and it's a tribute to all those who paid the ultimate sacrifice. Please rise and remain standing for the rifle salute, the playing of taps, and the lowering of the colors to half-mast. Please be seated. Okay, this time I'd like to call up Carmen Johnson, the president of the Michigan Chapter 198 of the Blue Star Mothers, to say a word.
Good morning. My name is Carmen Johnson, and I'm the president of the brand new chapter, Blue Star Mothers Chapter, Michigan 198, from right here in Troy. We are the Red, White, and Blue Star Mothers, and I'm the proud mother of two sons currently serving their country. Peter is a petty officer in the U.S. Coast Guard Reserve at Sector Detroit, and Ethan is a first lieutenant serving in the U.S. Air Defense Artillery, Army's Air Defense Artillery at Fort Hood, Texas. Ethan just returned from a 9-month deployment to Kuwait, and I'm grateful to have him home with his feet on U.S. soil. Blue Star Mothers is a congressionally chartered organization that started in 1942 during World War II nearby in Flint, Michigan. The organization is celebrating its 75th anniversary this year. We are the mothers of active military, reservists, members of the National Guard, and veterans of the armed forces. Our mission is to support our active military veterans and military families. I welcome all mothers of the armed forces and veterans to join us at 10 a.m. the third Saturday of every month at Kirby's Coney Island on Crooks and I-75 at our regular monthly meeting. Today, on Memorial Day, I want to recognize our Gold Star sisters, mothers who have lost sons and daughters in service to our country. Like Blue Star mothers, they have taught their children that it is honorable to serve their country, to give themselves in service for a greater cause. They have taught them that freedom is not free and service above self. They understand what the ultimate sacrifice really means. Today we remember the fallen, and it is right that we do so. But let us not forget the families that were left behind, the dear ones, the wives, and the children. We forget that many of the fallen had spouses and children waiting for their return. Never was this so impactful for me than the sight I saw when my son returned from his deployment. 100 wives and children awaited with us in that large gymnasium in the middle of the night, waiting for daddy to come home with banners and balloons, waiting for the big plane to land and our loved ones to emerge. Many of those babies were in carriages and never had met their father. And to think that their daddy would not be returning home would be heart-wrenching. To honor them, I would like to read a poem entitled "The Silent Ranks." I wear no uniforms, no blues or army greens, but I am in the army, in the ranks, rarely seen. I have no rank upon my shoulders. Salute, I do not give. But military world is the place where I live. I'm not in the chain of command. Orders I do not get. But my husband is the one who does. This I cannot forget. I'm not the one who fires the weapon, who puts my life on the line. But my job is just as tough. I'm the one that's left behind. My husband is a patriot, a brave and prideful man. And the call to serve his country, not all can understand. Behind the lines, I see things needed to keep this country free. My husband makes the sacrifice, but so do our kids and me. I love the man I married. Soldiering is his life. But I stand among the silent ranks known as the Army Wife. Congressman Tom McClintock, in his Memorial Day speech to Blue and Gold Star Mothers in 2011, said, "We need to remember that there are some among us for whom every day is Memorial Day." Ladies and gentlemen, time does not heal all wounds. The grief of our Gold Star families is just as great today as the day the casualty officer came to their door. Their loss is a heavy burden that they bear, that never grows lighter, that they will carry until finally reunited in death. Today, we remember. Let us never forget. And God bless America.
That, I think that poem was could have been written by my wife. All right, I'd like to thank everybody for attending this important ceremony in remembrance of all the men and women who have died in service to this great country in pursuit of freedom. This time I'm going to call up Pastor Cornwall for the benediction.
Thank you, Russ. It's a little bit daunting to see your closing remarks by your name, at least if you're sitting out there and knowing that a preacher is at the podium. But let me just thank you all for coming. You could be elsewhere, It's a gorgeous day. You have the weekend off, and yet you've come here today to remember, to celebrate, to honor. I didn't serve in the military. My father did. My grandfathers did. So I remember them. They did not die in service to country, but they did serve. I come as a member of this community, as a pastor in the community, and as a chaplain for the Troy Police Department. And again, from that perspective, I thank you for joining me and being here today. So as we get ready to go forth from this place, would you pray with me? Let us go forth from this place with grateful hearts. In a spirit of hope, we pray that peace will prevail among us all as we leave this place. Having remembered and celebrated the lives of men and women who served this country and died in its service, grateful for the freedoms that we have and treasure as a nation, which draws its lifeblood from the contributions made by the many different peoples who inhabit this land. We give thanks for our diversity as a community, as a nation. May we not take this blessing for granted, even as we pause to honor the memory of those we celebrated here today. And may we honor them by committing ourselves to service to community, nation, and world, so that peace and justice may prevail among us all. Amen.
Excellent. Okay, our departing song is going to be God Bless America, sung by Councilmember McGowan. At that time, the Honor Guard is going to be raising the flag, the full mast, a little early from the 12 noon, but, sir? Okay, that'll conclude our ceremony. Thank you all for attending. Thank you very much.